Podcasts World Hustle,
the recognized symbol of excellence in sports entertainment.
This is the Pro Wrestling Reflection Podcast with your host, the Professor Chalbello de la Cruz.
What a run!
Mr. Wonderful, Tommy Wonder.
And I will take the powers of those that have no fear!
And the prodigal one, JB.
The cream, yeah. The cream of the crop.
Now it's time to go back in time in the Homie Media Time Machine.
Two sweet!
An living legend, Bruno Sammartino.
Austin 316 says I just whipped your ass.
To be the man, you gotta beat the man. Woo! Look at this. He's having a goal. I don't believe it.
What is going on there, Reflectionites? Happy belated Thanksgiving, happy early Hanukkah, happy early Kwanzaa, merry early Christmas, happy early New Year. I know everybody's excited for 2021. Everybody is online to get the vaccines. What is your number? Did you pull that ticket? Are you number one, number two, number three for the Pfizer vaccine? You know, the professor, he's number 458,632. So I got a lot of time right now before I get my vaccine shot. So, you know, where am I going to take it? I got my arms ready. You know, I got the guns. I got the pythons ready. So TW knows about the pythons. It's 24 inches. So I can take a Pfizer vaccine.
You
I
can take 24 inches. That's great. Wow.
Shut the hell up right now. We're not 2021. We mean what we say. Not this double entendre stuff. But anyway, it's all about new beginnings. And we're so close. You know, new beginnings, new presidents, new philosophies, new ideologies. You know, some people are going to be pissed. New taxes. It's all good stuff coming in new 2020. But we got a couple of shows to close out 2020. And welcome, my friends. Welcome. If you're listening on PWHustle at podbeam.com, if our buddy A-Track Braun is video editing this for the PWHustle Networks on YouTube, welcome to all Reflectionites all over the globe. Even Pakistan, they barred us. But don't worry, we actually got the illegal prohibition copies sent to you. Sri Lanka, they banned you. But don't worry, we got the illegal tapes sent to you. So everybody, every Reflectionite all over the world is welcome to the PWR podcast here at podbeam.com, PWHustle Networks at podbeam.com. And of course, you know what we do here. We're the nostalgic show. We're the ones that go old school. We do old school movies. We do wrestling spotlights, greatest robberies, greatest managers, greatest vixens. And of course, we always review the classic shows that you probably didn't even know existed. And I will bet you money that none of you Reflectionites even knew that this existed back in 1989. What episode is this? I think this is episode 128. Big Ray Hernandez, Minister Big Ray Hernandez, will remind the professor what episode number we are. But anyway, before I introduce myself, yes, we are going to go back to 1989, April 15th, 1989 to be exact, because we are going to be talking about Professional Wrestling Federation. And if you opened your mouth saying, did this really exist, Professor? Don't worry, I'll explain it in a few minutes. But first, I must introduce myself. I am the magnanimous one. I am the scholarly one. But most importantly, for all the Reflectionites out there, you know me. I am the glorious one, the only objective man in the IWC, YWC, the only objective man on the Podbeams, the only objective man on the YouTubes, your friend and mine, the Professor Chababa Cruz. And I'm not here alone here. This man has been riding and dying with me for the past couple of years. He's ready to get 2021 started. But for some strange reason, Reflectionites, you know, while we were taking a little bit of a Thanksgiving break, this man was on a death wish. This man was eating death nuts. This man was eating death grapes. This man was doing hot ones, and he wasn't even getting paid for it. And now he's going to do death gummy bears. This man is cheating death left and right. He is your friend and mine, Mr. Wonderful, Tommy Strong, the iron lung, the iron gut, the iron stomach. I don't know what else to call him. The Tommy Wonder, how are you doing, my friend? And why are you so crazy of trying to kill yourself with these death foods, man?
You know, you nailed it. First of all, it's 2020 Wonder that's coming
up. Okay.
Second of all, what happened is, just shit snowballs. So a few months back, a friend of mine, I think in August, we went to a birthday party for one of my other friends, and they asked me if I ever seen hot ones before, and then I was like, nope, never heard of it. And I'll be honest, I don't know about a lot of stuff, let alone what's on YouTube. I don't even know about stuff on Netflix and Hulu and Prime and all that, although I did watch a show called Wayne. It's awesome. And I finally got around to watching The Punisher, and I'm about four episodes away from being pissed off when I get to the end of season two and find out that it's going to end in such a way that I never know how it finishes up. But back to the question. So on Hot Ones, that dude Sean, Hot Wings and stuff, and back in the summer, me and my buddy Chris, we did our own little hot ones, you know, and oh, that shit hurt me. And I don't eat hot foods, for the record. Mm-hmm. And so one of the things that's a spinoff of that guy is the one chip challenge. And I don't speak Scoville. I didn't even know what that word was until watching Hot Ones. I just know it doesn't take much to make me sweat. I did see Daniel Bryan take the one chip challenge, and he no-sold it like a son of a bitch. And my friend that did the one chip challenge with me said, I don't know who that guy is, but he's my new hero, because he literally no-sold the one-chip challenge, which I immediately, the second shoot. And for 3 days, I couldn't taste anything I drank other than it tasted like shit. Everything I drank tasted the same, but food was fine, so I was free of the COVID. And then at the chip challenge, which I did mine by myself because my friend Stacy and Matt did theirs the day before and didn't tell me, so I had to come do mine a solo tip. Which I just checked their YouTube page, which is Dum Dum Duo. First of all, it's a trio. And second of all, they didn't even put my one on the video. There's the one of all three of us doing the Death Nut Challenge, which I had absolutely no interest in doing. But I did it. I figured YOLO, right? Is that what you kids say? First nut in. First bite.
You said first nut in.
No, I was kidding. But so anyway, first one, I was like, nope. And the second one wasn't that bad. Until you were done eating it, and then all of a sudden it came creeping back up, and you're like, it's literally like fire rolling up your throat. The third one, I ate one of them instead of all four, because the other two dum-dums ate all four. And then my buddy's girl ate one of the fourth one, and none of us made it to the Death Nut. So in the Tower of Doom, Tower of Fear match, White Cat, whatever the hell that match is from Ready to Rumble, we failed that one. So tonight, we're doing the gummy bear challenge, which it's one gummy bear. You have to chew it for 30 seconds before you swallow it. And then my friends, Matt and Stacy, they have people. We know a lot of bar owners, and they're giving away like care packages to a different bar every time we do it. So the person that guesses how long we're going to make it combined before we need to drink something.
Hold on. What's wrong with these gummy bears? Are they hot? They're spicy?
It's called the world's hottest gummy bear.
Oh, Lord.
It doesn't even look like a gummy bear. It looks like a fucking, I don't know, what's that fancy chocolate bar? It comes in little squares, and when you break it, like, the caramel comes out of it. Not the caramello. I know that one. I'm talking about some little thin bark and all that. Like, they come in peppermint. Real fancy shit. It looks like that shape, but it's a gummy bear. And then this girl who I don't know, she's friends with my friend Matt. She's like, why would you guys do a gummy bear? You know you have to chew it, and it's going to get stuck in your teeth, and then you got to pick at your teeth with your tongue, and then your tongue's going to catch on fire. And I was like, listen, I already didn't want to do it. You just made it even more so. But we have fire chocolate on deck. Once we're done with the gummy bear this week, next week we're doing the fire chocolate. I think we might set up our own version of hot wings. There's more than enough places around here. We can just get hot wings made. But whoever can guess the combined total minutes – that Matt, Stacy, and I do not drink milk or eat ice cream or do whatever to calm the fire in our throats wins this package to this bar around here called Ireland's. couple drinks already in it, and then $100 gift card. And last week they won Boat Works, which is another bar that we know the owner. And so it's all in fun. But these idiots wanted to start a YouTube page, and of course they call it the Dumb Dumb Duo. And I'm like, hello. So it's the Dumb Dumb Duo and an idiot is me. I'm the idiot. But even though all three of us are idiots, for the record. So every time I do it, my taste buds don't work for 3 days. And then the next, you know, right when they're back and they're full, all back together, and I'm enjoying drinks again, there's another one on deck. So we'll see.
Well, you know what? I applaud you with your iron will, your iron stomach, or whatever. But you know what? Maybe this is a way to combat COVID. What you're doing? Gummy bears, chips, heat, extensive heat in the body can resist COVID-19 reflectionites. This is Tommy Wonder's, you know, cure. This is better than Moderna. This is better than Pfizer. This is actually free. No, well, there is a side effect. You're going to have a burnt tongue, or there is a side effect that you're not going to have no taste buds for maybe about 2 days. But can you can handle 2 days of no taste buds and be COVID free?
Food's fine. It's drinking something that may, I don't know what it is about liquid, but it absolutely tastes awful.
It's always milk. You got to have the milk available.
No. I don't mean like on the spot. I don't drink milk. Milk is disgusting, right? Okay. So to me, milk looks like a cow version of Peter North just filled the glass for you. It's disgusting. I want no part of it. I know you're into that kind of stuff, but
no, I'm not.
I have bukkake.
Yeah,
you had a bukkake?
No, I know it. I've heard it. I've studied abroad. That's what I'm trying to say here. But anyway, let's get into this show, TW. This is not the This is PWR. This is not the Hot Ones Network here. So, you know, we got to keep it going with the nostalgia. So we got to go back to April 15th, 1989. And again, Professional Wrestling Federation, TW. Number one, did you even hear of this federation? Because this is actually a federation. This is actually a wrestling city that you know. This is actually a wrestling style that we all talk about. This is Championship Wrestling from Florida. It was a name change. They were trying to get either global, universal. This was the last gasp because, you know, this is 1989 TW. This is WWF is everywhere in the United States, everywhere on cable TV. They're, you know,
Canada
and Mexico and all points in between. And, you know, the funny thing about PWF or Professional Wrestling Federation was this. It had a little bit of a boost, not much of a let's say money boost, but it was actually kind of like that wrestling community boost because somebody came home. It was the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, because he got fired from WCW or NWA, whatever you want to call it.
So this is
January 1989. This is pre WWF. This was a couple of months.
Confused me. Dustin is there, and didn't Dustin make his debut with Ted DiBiase, or he had already been wrestling for Florida before that?
No, Dustin made his WWF debut in 1990. Dustin Rhodes actually was going around the territories. He was in CWA, he was in NWA, and he was in PWF. So he made the rounds during those, World Class, not NWA. It was World Class. Right. So he was making the rounds there, you know, paying his dues, if you will. But this was Dusty Rhodes. You know, everything was about Dusty Rhodes coming home to Florida. So, you know, TW, before we talk about PWF in 1989, we have to get all the reflectionites to know why this is so big in the wrestling community. I mean, because Dusty Rhodes in the 70s ruled Florida. Because when he made the babyface turn, because he was a very staunch heel when he was with Dick Murdoch.
West and the Texas Ned Redneck.
Was it Rednecks or Outlaws? I forget.
Oh yeah, West Texas Outlaws. You might be right. I thought it was Rednecks.
But I think he was listening to Rap Is Crap while he was eating the hot ones. But anyway,
you can't spell crap without rap.
There you go. But anyway, he made that great babyface turn, and everything in Florida changed. Dusty Rhodes' career changed. So talk about any memories you have of Dusty Rhodes, not about this show. I'm just saying anything Dusty Rhodes with this Florida run, NWA, I mean, what it meant to the Southern wrestling community, because Dusty Rhodes was larger than life when he made that babyface turn.
I don't know shit about Dusty before I started watching him in NWA, but I know this. Dusty and Florida are synonymous, but so are Mike Graham and his family, the Eddie Graham and Steve Keirn. And funny enough, like Steve Kern's in here, Mike Graham's in here, Dusty's in here, and I'm looking at it, and I'm sitting here going, man, I thought Dusty was in WWF in the 90s, because I was thinking this happened in between Dusty leaving Vince and going back to Turner. But I'm like, not 89. And I'm like, how the hell's Dustin there? Because I remember the first time I ever seen Dustin was wrestling Ted DiBiase. If you can make it 10 minutes, he was going to get a job. And he right. did. And
that was 1990 though.
Yeah. But that's what I mean. I'm so confused by it all. And then I'm sitting there going, wow, why aren't they drawing if they got Dusty there? But they did do just like World Class, just like Memphis, just like, WCW, really, NWA, they filmed in that little studio, and then they cut in and show you clips of full arenas where they were full. And I just thought, man, how, like, I don't know how it makes you feel to watch this kind of stuff, but I just think it's too late to put the genie back in the bottle, if you will. Mm-hmm. But, like, it used to be TV was what got you. That was the next medium. TV got you and me to go see them live. And,
right.
And TV... Vince, I don't know if he's the one that did it, but Vince's TV was in arenas. And I remember I used to watch WWF on Saturday and Sunday mornings and think, wait a minute, they're coming here and I get Hogan versus Orndorff, Macho Man versus Ricky Steamboat. You know, one of those two were the main event. And then you had all these under matches that were guys who didn't fight on TV. Greg Valentine versus Owen Hart, you know, well, that's a terrible example because they wrestled at a WrestleMania. But
Dusty Wolf, you could say.
But no. I'm saying my house shows are that.
Mm-hmm.
But TV is the Ultimate Warrior versus Dusty Wolf in the 3-second squash and Outlaw Ron Bass versus Reno Riggins in the same 3-minute squash. And I remember thinking, who the fuck would go to that? Like, I would not want to go TV taping, but what it was is editing. Those matches were dark matches. And they weren't all on the same show. They would get their asses kicked in a dark match, and then it would be because my first WWF show, I think I talked about this before, there was a job guy named Tom Stock. And I watched him lose, didn't know who he was, didn't know if he – I didn't expect him to be a job guy, and I didn't know that term. And I'm saying job guy, not jobber, because I don't want to insult anybody. But I didn't know. And then he came out and watched the rest of the show by himself, and I asked my mom, hey – can I go over there? And she's like, yeah. And so I was within eyeshot of her seeing me. And I went over, you know, 12 years, 13 years old, whatever I was. And I sat and said, hey, did you just wrestle? And he's like, yeah, I did. And he signed something for me. And I sat there and watched a match with him. And then he said, hey, kid, I got to go. And he got up and he walked to the back and he went to the, you know, he got out of there. I probably ruined his plans of watching the whole show from out there. But but that was my introduction to it. But every time I'd watch Saturday morning or something like this, now, this is makes more sense to me because it's a small studio. It's like the WCW, you know, show, not the NWA's World Championship Wrestling, where most
the of for, but the formula was just like, let's use Jerry Lawler's territory because they do the studio and everything was to Mid-South Coliseum. Florida was the same thing. They did the studio and everything was for that big arena in Tampa, Florida or Miami or wherever the case may be. They wanted to make sure that they were, if it was an, I don't want to call it a stadium because I think they drew like maybe 500 people. So let's call it an armory. So if you have like 50 people in that little studio, you wanted 500 in the armory, but 500 people came for Dusty Rhodes in the armory. And the same thing, well, NWA was the only thing was about the studio. It was about the interviews to get to the bigger show. So, more talking, you know, sure. It was more talking. So,
and
for PWF.
That was a weird thing. When you went to a house show, there was no talking. Mm-hmm. So, it's almost like they really, really do their job because what if watching it, the talking is what you like the most about it? Then you go see it live and you're like, what the fuck? These guys aren't talking, but they're talking, telling you what they want to do. It was peanut butter and jelly. You couldn't have one without the other. You needed the talking show to get you to watch them at the house show or the local show, whatever. And now, it when they come here, it's very rare they come to Detroit and it's not Raw or SmackDown. Like, it's not just a regular show. And then once in a while.
Be patient. AEW will do it soon. Don't worry. AEW is going to be in the
track. And I would go. NXT's come here twice, and they sold out in 7 minutes. And and I didn't go. And I would have. But they went somewhere smaller. They didn't wrestle at the Little Caesars Arena, probably because they were afraid it wouldn't sell out. But it wasn't televised. What did you have to lose, right? Like, unless it was so much cheaper to rent the Royal Oak Music Theater versus renting the Caesars Arena. But
social media will call you out if you don't sell out. So that's the problem right now. So let's go back into this, because you said it's all about the talking here. Well, for me, looking at this episode, like, first of all, 1989 was the year I got cable. So I was so excited, because, you know, my first introduction of wrestling on cable was actually ESPN with World Class and AWA and Global eventually in late 89 and 90. But I did not get PWF. So I missed it. I didn't see it. I didn't know it existed. So when I looked at it, you know, and I saw Gordon Solie and Diamond Dallas Page. Now, I knew Diamond Dallas Page from AWA. Right. But I was like, he was here? This is...
Now it makes sense. All the stories he talks about, Dusty putting him under the learning tree. It was here.
Right. Right. It was right there. So what? Talk about Gordon Solie, because, you know, some people call him the dean of commentary. Some people think he's boring. He's cachet. You know, he's monotone. He puts you to sleep. So, TW, I mean, you knew what Diamond Dallas Page offered, because he was the quintessential heel trying to rev up the crowd and try to get you angry.
He did very well here, by the way. I kind of got
distracted by the New Jersey hair helmet mullet that Diamond Dallas Page
was. And his glasses looked like they had the Groucho Marx nose on them. Mm-hmm. I'm looking at going, what the fuck is wrong with his nose? And then I realized half of it was his glasses. They were like the Batman nose, and he had the Batman shirt on. So he was selling the 1989 was when the first Batman movie came out. So, but I mean, like, Gordon would say something, and it would be like this invisible baton passing, and DDP would be right on it. And I think there was too much DDP in the end, because he interviewed everybody, and they were always heels, and or he was just there with them while they were talking. But Gordon Solie, I think for me, I was never a Gordon Solie guy, and the reason is because when they brought him back to NWA, which was probably around the time Terry Funk and Ric Flair's feud was going on, I know they brought him back, but that's when I saw him. I don't know where he was before that. It felt like they pushed Jim Ross out for him, and because of the UWF and
I don't know. I don't know if he was put. I mean, because let's be honest here with the 89 thing, because I understand what you're talking about with Gordon Solie, because he did work NWA. But remember, Tony Schiavone went to WWF this year in 89. So there was plenty of Jim Ross, and now Gordon Solie was there.
But they didn't do it together. So
no, they did.
Jim Ross did it or Gordon Solie did
it.
And it felt like to me, because like you said, we both got cable in 89, me the ass end of 88. It was Gordon's. Well, 88 was Ross, and then 89 was Solie, and it's like,
and Lance Russell and Christopher Cruz. So there was a lot of things there.
My favorite guy is Bob Caudle, and but here's what I think happened. Solie is good when you think it's real. He is not good when it's sports entertainment. He has absolutely zero charisma. He almost comes across as that guy that just passed away, the actor studio interview guy, Jonathan Lipton.
Okay.
Just too serious. Like, you look at that guy, and you picture him smoking a pipe with his legs crossed and reading the Wall Street Journal, yet he's talking about acting. Mm-hmm. And me and you, when we think of movies, we think of shit. Like, I would hope you and I are similar in this. You think of funny movies first, right? There's been a lot of awesome, serious movies, but when I think of movies, I think of superheroes and laughing and shit like that. That ain't what that dude thinks of. And I think with Gordon Solie, he's not into the... I think he would have been huge for Stone Cold, because that seemed real. But I don't think he would have liked...
I put Gordon... I'll give it like this. I understand where you come. He's like Walter. He wants to be Walter Cronkite of wrestling. He wants to be Howard Cosell of sports.
And that's what Bob Caudle was to me. Yeah. Bob Caudle came across, first of all, he didn't come across as condescending. And I think Gordon Solie comes across as condescending. Like, I'm better than you. And So that I would give you Cosell or Walter Cronkite. Whereas Bob Caudle wanted to be, I don't know.
Peter Jennings?
Yeah, Kathy Griffin's husband, Gifford.
Oh, Frank Gifford.
Like, okay. Someone who's happy to be there, excited about the game. Like, Gordon Solie never seemed excited about the wrestling. And and Howard Cosell seemed more excited to talk about himself than the football. Like who's the other one? There's another. I'm trying to think Al of Michaels. A guy who just...
Al Michaels is happy Michaels, always.
He's happy to be there. I probably was thinking of Al Michaels instead of Frank Gifford, actually, now that I'd be honest, because they did it together. So it's really Al Michaels that I mean. Michaels was happy to be there. Chris Collinsworth takes a lot of abuse. He's happy to be there. He's a 50-something-year-old man who's still living the dream of a 13-year-old kid. He played, and now he talks about football. His whole life has been football, and I think that's what Bob Caudle was. Hey, you know, and then, like, if a heel did something, he's like, oh, you can't do that. And Lance Russell's very similar to Bob Caudle. Gordon Solie, there's no room for that in professional wrestling. He's a wrestling snob, I think. And I know Travis is listening, Travis Volts, and thinking, you're nuts. Gordon's the best ever, because Phil Apter probably thinks he's the best ever. So that means Travis does. But I prefer someone who's a little more loose, a little more happy to be there, and basically who's a kid living his dream.
Right, but you have to remember, when you have a Gordon Solie broadcast, it legitimizes whatever organization. Even the crappy Continental Wrestling that he did in Louisiana in 88, Gordon Solie was doing that. I didn't see it on cable, but you know, if you go on YouTube, you can find those things. So wherever he did the little shows in the Southern Wrestling territories, this is funny, TW, because you know, in 2020, we have streaming services, we have cable, we have YouTube. We can find these wrestling organizations if we wanted to. I mean, we couldn't find these wrestling shows on cable. This is funny because cable actually really followed the
Ring of Honor. So we're talking 10 years ago. I couldn't find Ring of Honor. So we're not finding nothing in 89, 90.
So you know, you're in Detroit, you can't watch PWF. I'm in New York, I can't watch PWF. And this is actually... I was lucky to get AWA, NWA too. So, you know, that's what I'm just saying. It's a godsend to at least see Gordon Solie there. That's what actually drew me to this and wanted to share with the Reflectionites. So, you know, you got Gordon Solie, you got Diamond Dallas Page. I saw him in AWA. And... you know, everything you said about Al Michaels, now I actually give a little bit of praise to Diamond Dallas Page. Even though he has the New Jersey 1980s hair helmet, he was happy to be there. He loves the business. I mean, everybody who's listened to Kayfabe commentaries, anybody who's listened to Diamond Dallas Page, Mr. Yoga, he loves the business. And he, you know, whatever, he was a sponge. He was the ultimate sponge. And like you said, you referred to it. Dusty Rhodes taught him as much as he could. He taught him about ins and outs of the business. He talked about the psychology. So, you know, Diamond Dallas Page owes a great debt to Dusty Rhodes. Final thoughts about this before
we talk. No one knows that more than Diamond Dallas Page. That's the beauty of it. That's gratitude.
That is sincere gratitude. So, you know what, TW? Again, we're not going to Reflectionites. When you hear the boardroom, number one, we're drinking. This is number one. There's no hot ones here. I'm not eating a death nut. I'm not having a chip. I'm drinking. So we're going to go from the beginning to the end to anything. So all points in between. We're just going to talk about what we see. So the first thing that caught my eye was all these wrestlers. I mean, you know.
Star power.
To begin, yes, you're right. There's a lot of star power, but we got to be honest here. That, like, in the beginning, you know, I was laughing when I saw Gator Scott Hall, who looked like Magnum P.I. on steroids, with his hair. It was kind of brownish blonde.
And this is post-AWA.
Yeah, he left the AWA. He left the AWA in 87, so he was already toiling around in the Indies. So he got his, you know, he is from Florida, if I'm correct here. So he followed Dusty Rhodes. I guess he followed the money, quote unquote. So he had an interview with going up against the Terminator. I don't remember the Terminator. I don't remember his real name, but TW.
That's his brother.
That's the third Laurinaitis. That is?
Laurinaitis.
Wow. We learned something.
And it's funny because we talked about him a couple weeks ago on whatever show we did where he was in there for 3 seconds because of that tag team. We talked about that tag team more. Right. And I was like, you know, now that I think about it, I think that guy, I think it was in the magazines, like Wrestling Eye used to have the Phantom or the Wrestler, mm-hmm. where he was right. supposed to be the guy breaking kayfabe in the locker room. And he talked about Road Warrior Animal's brother is coming out. He was called Crash the Terminator. And then he was just the Terminator. I looked him up because I'm like, I'll bet you that is. I looked it up on Wikipedia. He's 55 years old. He actually teamed with Johnny Laurinaitis for a while in Florida. Mm-hmm. And they were grooming him pretty good. And so when I saw him in here, first of all, we got to pick apart what we got to pick apart. The whole show is centered around the main event being Scott Hall. And he's not Gator Scott Hall. He's Big Scott Hall. Because Steve Keirn is Gator Keirn.
Well, it's 89. I'm calling him Gator. I'm sorry. It's Gator to me. It's always Gator to me. So I'm going to.
And it's funny because
wait.
He's doing jobs for WCW.
Right, right. But talk about the. I mean, Scott Hall has been in the business. I saw him in AWA in 86 and 85. Five. He was, you know. He was like the next. I don't want to call him like a Brock Lesnar. Let's not confuse it. TW. I'm not trying to say. But Vern Gagne had plans for Big Scott Hall, and it didn't work out because Scott Hall could not talk. I mean, in the 80s, his promo skills,
show, with the exception of Dusty, right. Punk could talk,
or Diamond Dallas Page. But talk about Scott Hall's lack of promo skills. It just sounded like he. He picked up a script. He was told what to say, and he just was like, I'm just trying to climb the ladder. I'm trying to climb the ladder here. Talk about that.
Well, it started off good because it's him and Crash on split screen. Mm-hmm. And as soon as he was done talking, the Terminator replied. And you could tell it wasn't live, and they weren't split screen, and they weren't replying to each other. But he basically touched on what Scott Hall said, you're my next rung up the ladder. And it's funny because – I would say most people would say Scott Hall can talk now, you know, survey says all that stuff. But yeah, it felt like he just threw a bunch of cliches in a hat and threw them out with absolutely no order or continuity to them at all. Mm-hmm. But nothing is worse than Dick Slater at the end of the show. So as bad as this starts, and Dick Slater even knows how bad it is because after he talks again, Dixon, come here. You know, I'm upset, so I'm saying a lot of stupid things. Like, he heals on his own promo and then goes and adds more dumb shit to the already worst promo of the show. And But I will say this. Scott Hall, as bad as he was, I thought Terminator's rebuttal was good. His was short and to the point. That's what made me go, that dude's related to Animal, because he sounded like Animal when he was talking.
And the makeup was like Animal's. And the haircut was like Animal's.
And the haircut, yeah.
So he kept it consistent.
Yep, and he wasn't around long, and he really just toyed. I guess he was also in a tag team in WCW called the Wrecking Crew, and mm-hmm. I remember the Wrecking Crew because Ole Anderson had him. But I remember it being the Beverly Brothers. I don't remember it being him and some other guy that's called the Colossus.
No, I don't know if I don't think it's the Wrecking Crew. I think is his name Mark? You said Mark Laurinaitis. Marcus, okay. I think he followed Johnny Ace.
They were called Crash and Fury, and they were called the Wrecking Crew.
No, but they went to Japan. I think more of his success was more Japan-based, not in the United States.
Back, Johnny Ace went and became Dynamic Dudes, and he formed a team with the Bounty Hunter. That was the guy's name. It was the Bounty Hunters, and one of them got hurt, so the Terminator filled in for him, and then they changed their names, and he became Mike Fury, and the other guy's name was Rage. So they were Rage and Fury, the Bounty Hunters. And then when they went to WCW, they were called the Wrecking Crew. And actually, they called themselves the Wrecking Crew in Florida right before going there. But they weren't there long. But I read all – they went over on Marcus Bagwell and Flash Funk. They went over on Too Cold Scorpio. Oh, that is Flash Funk, Too Cold Scorpio. Bagwell and Zinc. And he was a tag team with Zinc in Japan. So, I mean, he did a lot of stuff.
He moved around.
He never made it. You know, to the next level. And I don't know what he's doing now. It looks like he's a car salesman or something, the picture they showed of him. But he, we might as well just talk about the match. There's the
This epic match between Scott Hall.
That's supposed to be the main event.
Well, yeah. Let's just talk about this before we even talk about the match. Because PWF, Professional Wrestling Federation, the biggest villain here is Diamond Dallas Page and Sir Oliver Humperdinck. So basically, this whole roster is half of it is Dusty's guys of good guys, and Scott Hall's part of it, and half of the other guys is you're a part of the Diamond Exchange or Sir Oliver Humperdinck's crazy bunch. So I don't know. I know Terminator was there, the Southern Force, Big Steel Man, who is later we'll talk about Big Steel Man, and Al Perez. I lost count. It's like half and half. It's like
Fernandez.
Manny Fernandez.
Everyone
I mean,
everyone came out with Humperdinck.
Right. So it's kind of a funny situation here. So
job guys.
You know what this reminded me, TW? This reminded me of GLOW. This is Jackie Stallone, and this is the male version of GLOW because half the bad guys were represented. Well, they had managers again, like I said, Oliver Humperdinck and Diamond Dallas Page. So now we could go into the match that you want to talk about.
Well, it's a regular match. They're working each other. Scott Hall's throwing drop kicks, and they do a false finish. Because it's funny because the whole promo has you thinking Scott Hall's the one on the climb, right? Mm-hmm. The problem is Dusty's champion. So, obviously, the faces aren't going to go over if you're trying to build opponents for Dusty. And the main opponent for Dusty right now is Al Perez or Manny Fernandez. But so...
We'll talk about Dusty in a second. I get what you say. We'll talk about that.
Mm-hmm. Ugly belly-to-belly suplex. Just absolutely. And as soon as they land, he's already trying to reach for the ropes. And it's almost like Scott's pushing him. And he gets his foot on the rope. Scott thinks he wins. Nope, his foot's on the rope. By the way, probably the first time I've ever seen a manager tell a referee, hey, man, his foot was on the rope. And the referee went, you're right. Let's start the match over. I've never seen that before. So the PWF gets credit for that. And Scott Hall turns around, takes a kick to the gut, and takes the sloppiest DDT ever and gets pinned, but not right away. Like, the dude spits on him. Looks like he's going to go to the top rope and then goes, ah, fuck it, I'll pin him. So all in all, he's been laying there for like 5 minutes. And I'm just like, wow.
Okay.
Like, Scott Hall must have pissed somebody off to have that be the finish, or Terminator's just that green.
Okay, now let's go with our 2020 eyes here in TW. As you being the former wrestler, please explain this
always
to me
wrestler,
because
never former.
Okay, I'm just gonna say this. All right, always the wrestler, never the former. Okay, I'll give you that. That should be a shirt. You know, think about that, trademark that. But anyway, Scott Hall, I talked about it. I saw him at 85. So right now this is 89. He's 4 years strong in the business. Why would you book him 4 years in the business acting like a green person 6 months in the business? This looks like a booking for a wrestler 6 months in making rookie mistakes. Please explain to the Reflectionites, or if this is a mistake, or like you said, this is Dusty trying to get heat for the Terminator for a future shot at the heavyweight championship.
I got three words for you.
Give me this.
Road warrior animal. That's Dusty's boy. So okay. Dusty's going to put over his brother. Okay. I think Scott Hall looks like the Greenhorn because of the Terminator. I think Scott Hall was turning around expecting to get hit and DDT'd right away, but the guy took to get over there. So then he has to look like a dope who walks into the boot. And then again, it's a sloppy DDT. You know, when I first started training, I almost killed Rico, my tag team partner, because no one told me how to DDT a guy. I just did it and did what I thought I was supposed to do to not kill him, which was let go before we hit the ground. It's the opposite. You hang on tight so that your back hits and you're holding him up and his head isn't hitting. Plus, you got his neck and his head secure in your arm. So when I let go, Rico kind of falls forward and Donkey Kong's on his fucking head. And then my fat ass lands on him because, you know, and I did it out of nowhere. We didn't call it. I just grabbed him and DDT'd him. And then he's like, dude, you just almost killed me. He's got Matt Burn on his big ass forehead. And I was just like, oh, I'm sorry. And then I don't know if Mickey or Scott said, hey, you got to hang on to him all the way through. But I learned the hard way, or should I say Rico learned the hard way, that that DDT Scott Hall took was sloppy. And I wouldn't be surprised if Scott Hall bunked his head when that dude, you know, did it. Matter of fact, he might have been going up to do another move, and Scott Hall was like, pin me, motherfucker, because he's probably seeing stars on that DDT. That could have happened, too. But when it when he hit the DDT and got up, he looked mad when he spit on him. I was looking at it going, why the fuck would you spit on him? Like, what? What? Because there's another thing. Dick Slater, later on, guy botches a move. Dick Slater lays the stiffest elbow drop ever without being the point of the elbow crushing the guy's sternum. It was just all of his weight landing on the guy's chest. But that happened. Mm-hmm. People get mad at each other, and they do stuff. They shoot on him, and then they calm the fuck down. But when he spit on Scott Hall, I just thought, what the hell is he spitting on him for? And then he looks like he's going to do a move, and it looks like either Scott Hall or the referee tells him, pin him. And he goes, oh, and then pins him instead of going to do another move. But I think the Greenhorn was the Terminator, and it made Scott look bad. I think Dusty booked it so Scott didn't look bad because he thought he won. And he let his guard down, and then when he turned around, he took the DDT and got beat. But he only let his guard down because he thought the match was over.
Oh, okay, so again, that's the way it looked to me. I mean, I understand the cadence of it because he thought he won, but it just to me he kind of wrestled and his promo. I think it's the promos that gets the professor's goat here at TW. It just seems like he's 6 months in the business.
Kurt Hennig did all the talking,
right? And Greg Gagne did all the talking.
The AWA.
Yes, definitely. Definitely was a bad talker. And I'm looking here. He was actually carried by Steve Keirn in the talking department too. So, you know, I can stomach Scott Hall talking in the 80s if he has a buffer. That's what I'm trying to say. Yep. But here, he just looks like that six-month rookie making rookie mistakes. And he's 40 years in the business. That's all I'm trying to say here. So... Now, you mentioned Dusty Rhodes, so let me just try to fill in the dots here, Reflectionize. Dusty Rhodes is the inaugural PWF World Heavyweight Champion. This is the number one Dusty Rhodes as the Florida Heavyweight Champion. This is the old tradition of championship wrestling with Florida. But in the old tradition, the NWA champion, let's say if it was Ric Flair, Al Perez would be challenging Ric Flair for the NWA Championship because the Florida Heavyweight Championship was that prestigious. So that relationship is not there with the NWA. But I noticed one thing. AWA was being represented in the PWF. So this is again, talent exchange or the open door policy, TW, you know. And especially, and we'll talk about Dusty Rhodes in a second, but I have to say, Larry Sabisco, he was trying to make a name for himself. He was trying to challenge all comers. After the debacle with Jerry Lawler.
He challenged Hogan all the time on AWA.
Right. He challenged Hogan. He challenged Flair. He was trying to get prestige for the AWA title. And guess who accepted the challenge, accepted the call? Little Mike Graham, who looks like Mike Brady. I mean, he wants Hulk Hogan. He wants Ric Flair. And you get Mike Graham. And again.
Who's not even a champion.
He's not even the light heavyweight champion here. I mean, he's just Mike Brady. I don't know. Or Bobby. He looks like Bobby Brady. That's what it looks like to me. Look at that hair. He looks like Bobby Brady. I mean, TW, I mean, when you want to challenge Hulk Hogan and you get Mike Brady, Bobby Brady, a.k.a. Mike Graham, that's a notch lower. That's a lower tier. He should be fighting Dusty Rhodes. It should be title for title. It should be that old school PWF versus AWA unification match that ends in a draw. Agree, disagree, or you have a changing book, or you have a different booking style?
The problem here is the show is called Homecoming 2, and they're just – Sabisco's just added fluff. Because the headline is Dusty exacting revenge for Dustin on Terry Funk, as they call it the most horrendous feud of the year or whatever, which I don't think 89 was – Terry Funk and Dusty Rhodes feud was the feud of the year. I would say Steamboat Flair was a little higher up on the voters.
Well, again, we didn't have cable to see this being the feud of the year. This could have changed your mind. So respectfully disagreeing, but I get where you're saying because I think Flair and Funk was the feud of the year. No, hands down, that was the PWI feud of the year no matter what. So that was it. You couldn't top that. Nobody, no organization
Flair,
could top
or Flair Steamboat.
No, Flair and Steamboat was the match of the year. Flair and Funk was the feud of the year, if I'm correct.
It was the second half of the year, because the first half was Flair Steamboat, second half was Flair Funk. I'll give you that. Mm-hmm. So that means literally got his ass kicked by Dusty and then went right to NWA. and started feuding with Flair.
And that is the funny thing here. But let's go back to Dusty Rhodes. Dusty Rhodes is the inaugural PWF champion, Reflectionites. So, you know, again, he's adding name. He's adding his name, his likeness, the prestige. He's trying to get a buzz in the wrestling industry. Again, it doesn't work because probably about 2 months later, he signs a deal with WWF, and he has a dark match at the Boston Garden against Ted DiBiase. So I've seen that. We've all seen that. So that's neither here nor there, TW, but he's trying to, you know, help out his hometown.
Right.
So
his people.
He beats Tugboat to become the inaugural champion, aka Big Steel Man. And now he's got chasers. He's got the Florida heavyweight champion Al Perez. He's got Manny Fernandez, the Raging Bull. He's got Terry Funk. So TW, I mean, Dusty Rhodes is, you know, let's just say this. You know, people, some wrestlers like Ronnie Garvin goes on kayfabe commentaries and really lambast Dusty Rhodes for always booking himself in the main event. But TW, Dusty Rhodes is a money draw. So why should we be mad? Why should wrestlers be mad at that situation? If Dusty knows he can put asses in seats and he can get the people in, you know, there's always jealousy. I know. But please explain it to the Reflectionites, TW.
I already know the argument is going to be from a Ronnie Garvin. But just Ronnie Garvin's on your right, he's on your left, and you're booking the territory. Which one of them two guys are you going to make champion?
Dusty.
Right. And Garvin's argument is going to be, yeah, because he always put himself over, so you like him more. No, he's just better. He's a better wrestler. He's a better talker. Ronnie Garvin is another one. I watched some of that, the Starcade, where he lost the belt back to Flair. His promo is as bad as Dick Murdoch's in this show. And Dick Murdoch wasn't that bad. He was just
You mean
bad.
Slater.
Dick Slater. I mean, yeah, Dick Slater. Ronnie Garvin was boring. He was boring in the WWF. He was boring in WCW or NWA. The fact that they put the belt on him and he still bitches about Dusty, all I can think is they put that belt on him because Dusty had nothing to do with it, right? So almost like a stab at Dusty because maybe they thought about putting it on him for years and didn't. I would put that on Jimmy Garvin before I put it on Ronnie Garvin. Ronnie Garvin absolutely, this day, Pop Bort, I followed along with TV, and the TV made me want Ronnie Garvin to win. I don't necessarily think if you didn't get the put, he didn't make him want to win. The push they gave him did. Flair made me want Ronnie Garvin to beat him more than Ronnie Garvin made me want to see him win. Okay. I wanted to see Flair lose.
I'll give you that.
Whereas Dusty does not get, he never gets talked about as being the Mount Rushmore. Dusty Rhodes should be on a Mount Rushmore. He ain't on mine. But he should be on a Mount Rushmore because, especially someone who's
Nice little jab. Nice little jab there. I got to give kudos.
No. I'm just saying, Warrior, Sting, Brett, and Sean are not coming down for Dusty.
Okay, I give you that.
But that's as a fan.
Mm-hmm.
And again, all time, if you're picking someone to represent every decade or whatever, Hogan and Flair are going up there. Austin and The Rock are going up there. I mean, maybe you bump one for Cena. I don't know. But I'm a grown-ass man. I don't see me putting Cena on. I think Cena's – what he's done is incredible, how long he's been on top. Well, he's not anymore, but, you know, when he was. But as far as – if you're an anti-WWF guy, and there's a lot of them out there, and I don't mean the fucking IWC, YWC now. I'm talking about all time. Like, people who liked NWA who hated WWF and vice versa. I never hated the NWA. But if we're being honest, it's two different products.
Of course.
Funny enough, WCW had to, NWA had to become WCW, which became a WWF knockoff to beat the WWF. Finally, they figured it out. You're not beating them with this grandpa wrestling. You have to beat them with the entertainment and the shock value, and they did it. I was driving today and thinking, it's amazing to think Austin and The Rock, arguably two of the most popular people of all time. You would agree? They became popular while Raw was getting its ass kicked by Nitro.
Because they were free to express themselves.
But my point is, there's a chance we don't even know who these guys are if they lose more and never get a chance because WCW wins the war, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
So these guys, we already knew who Shawn Michaels was. Did he up his game? Absolutely. Did Triple H up his game? Absolutely. All these guys got better, Brett, all of them. But Austin and Rock became stars while they were getting their ass kicked. And it's amazing because what I mean is it just goes to show you how many people watch wrestling. Because even though Raw was losing, they still were having millions of people watch them. It wasn't like, you know, they were running out of money. That's why it's
and did. And to be fair, for Dusty Rhodes' purposes, he didn't become a bigger star. He was already big. Because of the babyface turn, he was already in that echelon, like you said, Mount Rushmore arc debatable. He was there in Florida. He was there in the NWA and now comes back in Florida.
To answer the question for guys like Ronnie Garvin and people who agree with him, Dusty Rhodes was champion so that no one could do to him what everyone threatens to do to Vince. What Brett did do until the screw job. What Medusa Michelli did, you know, not that she was world champ. Dusty, his bread and butter depended on the champion showing up. And who better to trust than yourself? It's of the course. Age old. It's why Vern Gagne was champion for 100 years. It's why the Von Erichs were champions for 100 years. It's why Steve Keirn, Mike Graham, or Dusty Rhodes were champions in Florida for years. And in NWA, it was Flair. But he proved to be a consummate professional, and they kept put Harley Race, Flair, and Dusty were the three guys. They're the Celtics, the 76ers, and the Lakers of the 80s for NWA. Because, mm-hmm. sure, you had a Tommy Rich run, or not long, Ronnie Garvin, a Kerry Von Erich. I don't even know who. Did Youngblood win it from Dusty or Flair?
No.
He never won it, but he chased.
Yeah, he chased. But I get what you say. You depend on the guys who put asses in seats, who are professional, who are trustworthy.
But you depend on the guy who's going to show up, who's not going to take your belt and go home. And the bottom line is, all these guys that go on these kayfabe commentaries and run their mouths about people, fucking Outlaws did it at Triple H, right?
Right.
X-Pac probably did it. Ronnie Garvin did it. All these guys have something in common. They're the type of guy who would take their ball and go home. They're not. They're so worried about themselves.
Right, right. But let me ask you
shit about other people.
But let me ask you this: for the inaugural PWF champion, would it have been better for Dusty to chase Tugboat instead of the other way around? Hindsight being 2020.
If he lost to him,
right?
If he lost to him, no. Mm-hmm.
No.
Because if Dusty comes there from the NWA and loses, then what value does Dusty have?
Okay, I'm just playing the hindsight. Right. I'm just playing the hindsight.
But do you understand what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Dusty is he's the big shark in the little pond. He comes in there and then loses to somebody. You do that if you don't plan on him sticking around, then he just made Big Steel better. Right?
Mm-hmm.
But if Dusty's coming there for the long haul, which ended up not being the case, then yeah. So in hindsight, you have him lose because he wasn't sticking around.
Right.
But your plan was for him to stick around, and him losing and chasing for the belt. The only way you do that, you have Dusty lose in the first fucking round because Terry Funk cost him. Then he gets distracted. Someone else wins the belt. Dusty finishes up with Terry and then chases the guy. Says, hey, I would have made it further in that turn. As a matter of fact, you have him lose to the guy who eventually wins. And that's why his gripe is, like, you wouldn't have beat me if this guy didn't help you. You mm-hmm. can do that. But only if he sticks around.
Yeah.
He just said it. 2 months later, he's WWF bound.
And the funny thing is, again, reflection.
Did he lose it to Perez?
No, he lost it to Big Steel Man. And then Big Steel Man goes to the WWF. So it's kind of funny. It's kind of apropos here. But Dusty Rhodes has got chasers. Al Perez is one because he's the number one contender, the Florida champion. Manny Fernandez is a chaser. Terry Funk, again, the history, the Rhodes and the Funks. And, of course, Funk destroys Dustin Rhodes. We don't have to talk about that, TW. But Dusty Rhodes it's the old NWA formula. He's the man, and everybody is gunning for the heavyweight champion. I think you said in our history of doing PWR podcast that, you know, on the NWA side, with when it's all talk, it kind of gets, I don't know, mundane. It kind of gets watered down. I mean, everybody keeps talking about the same person, but then we never really focus on something. I mean, I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, but that's the way it comes off when you say that. It's just like, you know, WWE focuses on the entertainment, but they focus on that actual feud. Whether it's 2 months or three months.
I just mean the appearance is entertainment.
Right. The appearance.
You're still talking, you're still wrestling, but mm-hmm. you're putting on bells and whistles that NWA didn't. There wasn't no motherfuckers in WWF with no knee pads. I can tell you that. And if they were getting squashed on Saturday morning. They weren't winning.
There was no knee. No, Iron Mike Sharp did not wear knee pads.
Yes, he did. Oh, no, he didn't. But he was doing jobs.
Well, there you go. But he was the most famous jobber. But anyway, Reflection Ice, we have the Chasers here. And Al Perez, you know, the funny thing is, do you call Al Perez untapped potential? They tried with him in the NWA in 1988. It didn't work. He goes back to Florida, becomes the Florida Heavyweight Champion. And then we know the story that he was supposed to be the Black Scorpion, and then he bails to go to the WWF. So I don't know Al Perez's story. I don't know Al Perez's cadences.
Al Perez looked the same every time. Every time. He looked like a knockoff Tito Santana with his white tights, his white knee. He was good in world class. He was good. He was with Gary Hart, I think, in the NWA when he first got there.
Yes, he was.
Mm-hmm. And I think they were priming him for a babyface Ric Flair fight. When he got to WWF, he was always on, and I don't know what shows they were. I'm just going to use the example because you'll know what I mean. He was on the Shotgun Saturday nights, the Sunday main event.
He was on Superstars and Wrestling Challenge, fighting the jobber, getting that win. But then when he has the Madison Square Garden house show, he loses to the main eventer bad guy. That was his forte.
Right. So he wasn't even mid card. He's knocking on the door, but he was just bland. Mm-hmm. And it's funny because in his interview. Dick Slater, Manny Fernandez wouldn't shut the fuck up every time. And he finally just laughed at him and said, you tell him, baby. I think we would all agree Bret Hart can talk, right?
It took years, though. It really took years.
No, it didn't take years. I know what Bret Hart feels like because when I was by myself, I talked my ass off. But when I was with Pilon and Libido was our manager, mm-hmm. those guys talked for 5 minutes before they said, tell him, Tommy. And by then, no one wants to hear another person talk for 5 minutes. So I'd be like, you guys covered it. Let's go. You know, because I could have talked, but those guys lived for it. So I let them. So for a good 2 years, I never, ever spoke when I was in that tag team. Because by the time they got to me, they said everything that we could say. And Bret Hart would be sitting there. Neidhart would talk. Jimmy Hart would talk, and they'd go to Bret, and he'd be like, yeah, mm-hmm. Eddie, and stick his hands out. Because what else is he going to add to it?
Mm-hmm. The punctuation. It's the punctuation.
And he did. He started calling himself the best, or I think he called them the best there is, or best of the world, before he started calling himself it. But the bottom line is, Al Perez, you could see, because Humperdinck talked, then Raging Bull talked, and then Al's just waiting. He's the guy with the belt. Actually, I don't think Humperdinck talked. It was DDP talking, then mm-hmm. Manny Fernandez. And then he was just like, all right. And then every time he tried to say something, fucking Manny Fernandez wouldn't shut up. And I'm like, dude, let him talk. And then finally he's like, blah, 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 you tell him, baby. And I just thought, fuck.
Al Perez has got the belt. Al Perez is
just
the number one.
Huge Al Perez fan when I was younger. I loved him on NWA. I loved him on WWF. Like, I loved that he was there, just like Terry mm-hmm. Taylor. I'm like, hell yeah, this dude's going to be a star. And then he just fizzled out. But, you know, it can't all be blamed on Vince, because sometimes the bright lights of the big city, people can't handle it. And I want to say Al Perez was one of the dudes had a little bit of a chemical issue.
We're not going to say that. We're going to speculate.
I think that's why he got let go from the WWF, is failing a drug test. I'm not certain.
Okay.
But I want to say that's why it was a short, brief run. Because the dude, you know, had his issues, but
our sources is CNN, Newsmax, or Breitbart. We don't know. It's not fact checked, so that's the way we'll say it here. But again, before we go to our first half break, where our executive producer extraordinaire, Minister Big Ray, is going to play all the clips here from this episode of the PWF. Again, let's put an exclamation point on Al Perez. Then why have him as the heavyweight, as the Florida heavyweight champion if he's not going to talk? Put the belt on Manny Fernandez or put the belt on Big Steel Man to be the chaser, because Big Steel Man talked even for 30 seconds. He talked. Manny Fernandez
talked. Al tried to talk. Tried to talk, damn it. And they wouldn't let him.
Well, Al Perez has got to grow some balls. That's the way I look at it.
Absolutely.
He's got to grow some balls. And with that being said, Reflectionites, we're going to take a little pause for the calls here and play the first half. Well, not the first half. We're going to play the clips of this episode of the Professional Wrestling Federation from April 15th, 1989, here on episode 128 of the PWR podcast at the PWHustle Networks at podbean.com. Minister Big Ray, take us to church.
Burns got that sleeper hold, and Al Perez in desperation now. That forearm coming across the... Rooster trying to get into the... Oh, wait a minute.
What is this?
Manny Fernandez just came in.
Today I have the opportunity to climb another rung up the ladder. Terminator, I'm going to take you out.
Big Scott Hall, if you think you're going to use me for a stepping stone today, you got another thing coming you'll never forget.
Thank you. Thank you so very much. And hi, everybody. Welcome to Florida Championship Wrestling, sanctioned, of course, by the Professional Wrestling Federation of America. I'm Gordon Solie, and we've got a tremendous hour in store for you. If you're wondering where my co-host is, my color commentator, Diamond Dallas Page, he said he'd much rather be introduced with a little music. So, if we may, let's bring on the Diamond Man himself, Diamond Dallas Page, and we'll see what's on his mind for this week. While we're waiting for him to appear, let me also remind all of you that, of course, as you just heard, we will have the big matchup coming. Scott Hall facing the Terminator, and that should prove to be quite a match indeed.
Hey, Gordy, what's happening, baby?
Woo!
Welcome I feel
aboard,
so good
sir.
Tonight, baby. You know, let me show you about it. Since one of my fans sent me this, people have been calling DDP the Cape Crusader. Get ready, all the evil here, baby. All the evil. Professional Wrestling Federation, brother.
Well, I'll tell you what, it's going to take more than a Cape Crusader. We've got a Super Slam contest coming up later.
Woo! That's right, the Commandos, brother.
Right.
$1,000 for anybody who can slam either Commando, brother. Well, I know it ain't happening today. It ain't sure ain't going to happen tomorrow. Not either one of those two boys, direct from the front line. You know, Gordon, I don't want to talk about that. Let me talk. Don't interrupt me when I'm talking, buddy. Now, listen, man, I know you've been looking a little down lately, a little under the weather. You know, I brought you Elvis, I brought you diamonds, I brought you gold. And I got something special here. Crank up that music right now. And let's bring out a little special treat here regarding shut up when I'm talking. Crank up that music. Where is it at? I got a special treat here for you. Hey, bro, I got a special treat here for you, man. When I get a treat going here, bring them ladies out. Bring them dolls out here. We don't need any music for this. This speaks for itself, brother. You know, me and my man, the Hump, Sir Oliver Humpering, that is. We are partying down, having taken out a few cold ones out in Tattletales. And I brought a few ladies here just for you to meet, baby. They all want to be down to dolls, you know that is.
Well, the name on the marquee is wrestling, and right now he's got a side headlock on Scott Hall. Hall fires him off. Hall catches him a nice drop kick. Ha-ha! That'll ring a 9-11 for him, I'll tell you that.
His foot's on a rope! Right
well,
there!
Well, we had
right.
the bell, we
his
had the bell.
His foot was on the rope, baby. Right there, his foot's
now,
on the rope.
Now, the referee explaining that now
keep
to Scott
going,
Hall.
Beautiful!
Oh, man.
Woo! Oh, beautiful!
The DDT on Scott
he ain't
Hall.
Up now, baby.
And Hall was not prepared. He was not prepared at all.
He knocked himself out.
Well,
I didn't know where he was for a minute there, bro. Woo!
Two pins
beautiful.
In that match. Two pins as far as I'm concerned.
The legal one was right there, baby. The referee went for the 1-2-3 Terminator. That's right.
Well, beautiful. I don't know about that because woo! Scott Hall, at that point in time, thought the match was over, so he was caught totally unprepared.
You know, last week, the situation is the shot heard round the world. Dusty Rhodes pinned on television by Al Perez, the Raging Bull, Manny Fernandez. Since coming back to the Professional Wrestling Federation and Florida Championship Wrestling, I've had to deal with a lot of adversity. Terry Funk and my own son, from my Lawrence, Dustin Rhodes,
taken out for 4 weeks in the career of a 19-year-old kid. Dealing with debt, accepting the challenge of the funk, accepting the challenge of the Al Perez's, the Matty Fernandez, the Big Steel Man, accepting the challenge of the fact is, and get it straight, I left the National Wrestling Alliance because I could not be bought. When I signed on with the Professional Wrestling Federation, I knew it was headed to the top. You were never able to buy Dusty Rhodes the American Dream. No amount of money can take the love that me and the mass millions across this country have for each other. Now then, Daddy, I will deal with the Terry Funk situation. They say the feud of all feuds. I will deal with Al Perez and the Raging Bull. I will deal with the Big Steel Man. Because why? Because I cannot be bought. And I told y'all, from the great WWF, the great AWA, the great NWA, if you want Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream, come to Florida and get him.
Massive forearms across the back.
Oh, yeah.
Man, he fought.
Now he's right. He's got to warm up a little bit there, got it?
Awesome in a lot of trouble right now. In a lot of trouble.
Awesome trouble. He's in awesome trouble.
Wow.
Oh, beautiful.
Flying headbutt by Al Perez. Awesome tried to fire back, but that punch lacked authority. Perez sets him up.
Oh, my God. That guy's going to be 270 pounds.
He's going into that chopper swing.
The alley copter, third floor, baby. Oh! He's getting up for that, baby.
Wow. I must say that that was an impressive duo. Reversal that time, and Backlund up and over tried to catch his man. Graham hung onto those ring ropes. Backlund's got some problems. Yeah. Graham in behind him. Belly to back suplex in a beautiful high bridge.
Got the count of three.
Got the count of three. Mike Graham defeats Jim Backlund.
I'll tell you, baby, let's send this to some impotent messages.
Ring against the masked assassin and brother, the Steel Man, is wasting no time whatsoever as he is putting some hurting on him in a hurry. 385 pounds, and he catches him in that massive, it's El Cid, caught him in that massive bear hug. Down across his throat. He is after Dusty Rhodes in the Professional Wrestling Federation of America Championship. And if this is any indication of what is in store for Dusty,
it's going to be tough. I told the world once, get over here, big man. I told the world once. I'll tell you again, this is the finest professional wrestling instrument today. That's right, at 385 pounds, the big B-A-double-D man, Steel Man.
See what Sags is able to do here.
Can't wait till the man gets here, baby. I'm ecstatic.
Well, seeing is believing, I believe. He's got him up. Almost had him, almost had him. He missed with that one. Up a full body slam, a full slam. He got it with a full body slam. What do you mean nobody saw
it? Nobody's seen it. The referee's back was to it. That's the man who counts it.
Hundreds of thousands of people watching just like I am saw it, that's for sure.
Yeah, they just saw him throw him right out of the ring there, brother.
Well, now, Knob's being attacked by both Boone and Ray. The Commandos have him. They bring him up for a full body slam.
There was a body slam.
Oh, my man, double.
A body slam, woohoo.
Double.
Slam it on the body, brother.
Oh.
You got, the referee has got to see it. You know, that's like a stipulation, brother, in any kind of rules.
Well, say what you will, nonetheless, we saw him slammed. As far as I'm concerned, we definitely saw him slammed.
And the, who you didn't think was going to be here, the man who was here, Terry Funk was here. He made it simple enough for even these functional illiterates to understand him, so he spoke very slowly. So even they could understand him, babe. You know, he had a lot of good points there. You know, I thought he expressed himself.
Hold it.
Perfect.
Steve Kern's got the sleeper hold. Steve Keirn got the sleeper hold on Rick Diamond.
And in this Australian tag team match, one fall, television time remaining. And the referee is calling for the bell. The referee calls for the bell as Steve Keirn dispenses Rick Diamond, and Dick Slater had earlier dispensed the Gladiator himself. And so it is indeed a quick victory for the team of Keirn and Slater. And obviously, of course, they're looking to gain that Florida Tag Team Championship. Here we see them in action now, and Keirn moves in, and notice the skill with which he applies that sleeper hold to Rick Diamond, forearm across that carotid artery. I might point out now, for all of you youngsters who are watching this, this is an extremely dangerous, lethal hold. Please do not attempt it on your friends. This is a lethal hold.
All righty, Reflectionites, welcome to the second half of the PWR podcast here at the PWHustle Networks at podbeam.com. And we heard the clippings from this PWF episode from April 15th, 1989, exclusively on YouTube. Reflectionites, go on the YouTubes, type in PWF, April 15th, 1989. It is a great, you know, it is for the times, TW. It's a great episode. And for the six-month run that it had on TV, we know that it was pre-recorded. They probably did like the old Impact Wrestling. You take four shows one night, and it kind of like spreads out for a whole month. So, you know, whether Dusty Rhodes kind of like, it felt like Dusty Rhodes was in this organization for like 6 months. He actually left probably weeks even before that to go to the WWF. That's the way it felt to me. But anyway, speaking of Dusty Rhodes a little bit here, he wanted to get revenge, and we're talking about this homecoming thing. Homecoming 2, he's going to have a Texas bull rope match against Terry Funk. It's not in this episode here of Reflection Nights, but the one thing that proves to a lot of people here, you know, when it comes to social media, when it comes to streaming services, you know, when I saw Terry Funk, he was a commentator on NWA TW. I thought he was retired. He filmed Over the Top. He filmed Roadhouse with Patrick Swayze. I literally, and I'm 11 years old. So again, I'm not attuned to the business. I literally thought Terry Funk was retired from wrestling until he did what he did to Ric Flair at Wrestle War 89. And then, you know, he had that run for the feud of the year in the NWA. Lo and behold, he's wrestling his ass off. He's blood, you know, blood, sweat, and tears, doing bull rope matches, going crazy, you know, middle-aged and crazy. He's already doing that here in this little organization called PWFTW. I mean, we don't know. This, you know, Terry Funk is doing what he's doing. He's doing what he loves to do, but we can't watch it. We're not enjoying it, TW. I mean, we were deprived of Terry Funk. The personification of Terry Funk's excellent promos, his wrestling matches. What say you about this? And just not knowing this, I feel cheated. Don't you feel cheated?
And wasn't he doing Japan? He was doing
probably Japan. Yeah.
And I think in 89, 90, I was still reading magazines, and I'm pretty sure I knew he was still doing something somewhere. Mm-hmm. And one thing we didn't talk about was they made it out. PWF was actually made out to be a governing body. It wasn't that promotion. It was Florida Championship Wrestling. It went from Championship Wrestling of Florida or from Florida.
Yeah.
To FCW.
But it was to get away from the NWA thing. It was to get away from that.
What you're saying was PWF, and that's where the AWA came in, is the PWF was the matchmaker. They said everything was booked and sponsored by the PWF, and that's why these shows had AWA guys and Florida guys. But they almost did reverse WCW. WCW was the name of the TV show, and then it became the name of the promotion. Florida Championship Wrestling was the name of the promotion, and then it became the name of the TV show for PWF. Mm-hmm. So Terry Funk, to me, we were watching something with him besides the Flair stuff. I thought he looked in the best shape ever when he would, like, he looked bloated in WWF when he was wrestling with that double cross branding iron and everything. Like, mm-hmm. he was roided up, right?
Right.
And then the NWA stuff, he just looked like he worked out. You know, like, he just looked, he was in better shape to me. He was smaller, but in a better build. And then this Florida stuff, he looked great. So 89, 90, Chainsaw Charlie, that's mid-90s, right?
Yes. That was 98.
Then he's starting to look a little old in the tooth. Yeah.
And of course, well, that late? of course, ECW was 95, 96, 97. And, of course, that was supposed to be his swan song. Right. So, and he was already in his 50s doing all right. that, his crazy shit. So, yeah. Again, we were deprived. Right. That's the thing I just want to say. It's like, again, as much as cable is that premium, we just don't – we didn't even know that he was doing what he was doing. Again.
What was his reasoning? Because it was probably kayfabe, but I remember reading in the magazines that he just went home to work on the ranch or something.
Probably something like that. He always played it like he was working on the ranch, the Double Cross Ranch in Amarillo, Texas. But again, from the NWA purposes, he was doing these commentaries with Jim Ross on Clash of the Champions, you know, propping up Ric Flair. And then, of course, they build it beautifully at WrestleWar. So, but then he got his jollies off by fighting Dusty Rhodes in Florida in these Texas bull rope matches at Homecoming. So, you know, he got his timing. He got his cardio. He got in great shape. And I said this to you on a past episode. In 89, his look was good. And the run that he had was the best Terry Funk run. Not, you know, hands down. Even with him as the NWA champion in 1976. Yeah, he had his best look and his best run, hands down. So, you know what, TW? There was another thing that kind of struck, that caught the professor's eye here. And it was the $10,000 body slam challenge. You had two 450-pound dudes called the Commandos. And the funny thing is, not about the Commandos. I get, TW, the body slam challenge. You're big. You know, you offer $10,000. And you're supposed to get these greenhorns to try to pick you up. But I was surprised at who actually answered the call. It was Knobs. It was Sags. It was the Nasty Boys. Again, I saw them in the AWA on ESPN, and they just popped up in Florida, Championship Wrestling, answering the call. The fans loved them. They were playing Janet Jackson's Nasty Boys. So, you know, they were the good guys, TW. I mean, this was pre-Stink Faces. This was pre, you know.
Pit Stop.
Oh, the Pit Stop. Excuse me. Reflection Nice. But how did you, you know, I never really, even in the AWA, I never gravitated towards the Nasty Boys. I thought the look was ridiculous. I didn't take them seriously as even baby faces because they had wars with the Midnight Rockers. They had wars with Paul Diamond and Tanaka, the Diamond Exchange in AWA. And again, they're going after the $10,000 body slam challenge against these 450-pound dudes. What say you, TW?
I agree with you 100%. I was never a Nasty Boy fan. I don't ever see me being one. I will say this. I seen him in the NWA, WCW, whatever the fuck it was. Because they were there first before WWF. I think they AWA, NWA, then WWF. I think the WWF did a good job of making them seem larger than life. Because this shit in Florida, they look like little kids. Like, I was thinking, is this where they started? You know, because it wasn't, because they were in the AWA sooner, earlier than that, right? So, did they never win the NWA World Tag Titles?
Well, it didn't count, but, I mean, WCW, you count WCW? The NWA were, before it turned the name, it was the WCW. Right. They were WCW Tag Team Champions.
Won all three, like the Road Warriors. Unless they never won the AWA.
Never won the AWA, no.
Okay, and then... The Dudleys are the only ones to be ECW, WCW, and WWF, but it's a tainted WCW because it was in the WWF that they were tag champs, right? So, but I just never liked the Nasty Boys. And again, I'll admit it, I was a body guy. I didn't like any of those dudes that didn't look like fucking the Ultimate Warrior, Sting, or Luger. You know, if a dude came out looking fat, like he was just a shitty stepdad to somebody, I usually didn't like him. So, I don't like Tugboat when he came to be Hogan's buddy. I think he looked way better as Typhoon. I think we talked about this before, gimmick changes that worked. Typhoon was from Tugboat was night and day, like take serious versus not take serious. Then, of course, he regresses all the way back to the bottom of the fucking barrel with Shockmaster. But
this was Shockmaster in PWF. The way he looked was Shockmaster-esque.
Horrible.
Yes.
Yeah, big Josh, bigger Josh is what he looked like. But I was never into guys like that. I think I was conditioned not to like guys like that because those are the guys they fed Hogan. Mm-hmm. Hogan always beat the guys that look like that. So it's almost ingrained in you to see someone that looks like the Nasty Boys who, yes, not the same size, looked like another King Kong Bundy, looked like another Earthquake or Typhoon. Not as big, but they just didn't look athletic. And I bet you there'd be people tell me I'm nuts if they were athletic. They ran a lot. They jumped. I hated sags more than knobs, but I hate knobs. But sags was the worst to me. I don't know if it was the fucking tooth missing. I hate it when he talked. But when they were WWF.
But who slammed? But look who slammed the commando. It was Sags. Yeah, that's the funny part.
The Knobs takes the slam to lose. And then the worst double splash ever. You know he was hoping they got right the fuck off of him. Because you know he can't breathe. One's on his chest, the other's on his face.
Now let me ask you.
The commandos?
Why? Because they didn't wear underwear?
On their side. They didn't make it on their side.
Boom. But let me ask you this question here. Like, being the wrestler you are, if you agree to take a double splash from the commandos, are you saying anything in the locker room?
If they hurt me?
Yeah. I don't think
especially if they're green.
Oh, okay. I'm just saying. Did it look like it hurt?
He disappeared. I think they took care of him. I think they did all right. Mm-hmm. But my thing is, when you do that, you just got to get right off of them. Because it's not the landing on them that hurts. The ring's got some give, and they're all soft, fat fucks. No offense. But not to you, to whoever's listening and takes offense. And I only say that about them because they're supposed to be athletes. That's my thing. Like, I hid my body when I wrestled because I was small, not because I was out of shape. Now, if I went and wrestled, I'd be hiding my body because I'm out of shape. And I'm way bigger than most of these little fucking backyard wrestlers in the business these days. But I digress. But those guys, as long as they get off of him right away, he's fine. But if they stay on top of him, for one, they're restricting his chest from breathing. And two, the other guy's on his face.
Right.
And you thank God they're fully dressed, because the last thing you want is a sweaty, fat belly landing on your face. You don't want that.
Or sweaty 450-pound balls.
He's from your area. He's from Jersey. But you ever heard of Dirty Don Montoya? He used to wrestle with the Reckless Youth all the time. Big dude.
Never heard of that name.
So he lays a chair over my face. He goes, look, I'm going to lay this chair over you. I'm going to give you the elbow like Cactus Jack from the ring apron to the floor. And I go, dude, you're going to land in that chair. That chair's going to fuck me up. He goes, no. I'm going to land by your chest. And I go, all right, man. So he lays this fucker on my face. He lands on my chest, but there's only one problem. It's a steel chair. So wherever the seat goes, the back goes with it. And it blew my jaw out. I thought my jaw broke on both sides.
Oh, wow.
Lucky for me, it just popped out of place. And then he pinned me. My teeth came through my lip, like underneath my little soul patch here. This little scar from my teeth. It actually didn't come through. It cut the inside of my mouth. And then the outside split from it stretching, if that makes sense.
Wow.
Like stretching around my teeth, but not my teeth coming through it. So like something rubbing on a corner. And then my jaw was just stuck down, like trap jaw, just wide open. And he pinned me, and I did something, and I heard my jaw go click, click, and it popped back into place. And then I said, you motherfucker, why he pinned me? And then we got in the back, and this dude's three times my size. He's from Jersey. He's probably got more connections than me. But I didn't give a fuck. I went right up to him. I go, dude, don't you ever fucking do that to anybody again. He's like, it hurt? I go, dude, you landed on the seat. But the back is connected to the seat, and it went down. I go, dude, you blew my jaw out. He's like, oh, I'm sorry. But I had to say something, because if I didn't, and he did it to someone else, he might fucking break their jaw. And most of us are wrestling for $20 and a handshake, so and a hot dog. So you don't want to hurt nobody. And then I wrestled a guy in Cleveland. He punched me so fucking hard, he put his hand over my face and then punched his hand as hard as he could. Every time he punched his hand, I saw stars, like literally, like he was just giving me repeated concussions. Finally, I boot this guy off of me. His name was Roadhog. And I hit him with the frog splash and didn't put my knees down. I deload him. And I just clobbered him. I hear him shit. I don't know if he shit himself, but I hear everything leave his body and him go, ugh. And I pin him. And we get in the back, and there's two curtains. I'm behind the second curtain. He's behind the first curtain. And in front of him is the audience. And
right.
I hear him telling this other guy, dude, he fucking killed me with the frog splash. Oh, and the super kick. And he goes, so I hear him. I wait till he's done. I nudge Larry Destiny. I go, watch this. I poke my head through the curtain. I go, hey, kid, how was it out there? He's like, oh, it was great. Thank you very much. I go, how was the super kick? He's like, good. I go, how about the frog splash? I go, felt a little stuck. He goes, no, it's perfect. I go, all right, buddy. I go, hey, watch those fists. He goes, huh? I go, you were knocking the shit out of me with those punches. And he goes, I was punching my hand. I go, yeah, which was on my face. And I go, work on him. He's like, oh, thank you very much. But it was constructive. I gave him his receipt, but I basically let him know the reason you almost shit yourself is because of how hard you were punching me out there. And you're taught to do that. If someone takes liberties with you and you don't take them back, everyone's taking liberties with you from now on.
You learn things here in the PWR podcast from TW. You know, like I said, if you look at this move, again, we don't know how many years the Commandos had, but doing that move, 450 pounds, you know, no matter how much they can protect Brian Knobs or Jerry Sachs, I forgot who took it, they're gonna have a talking in the locker room. So
unless it went well,
right? I think it probably went well, but
they would still have a talk and say, "Hey, man, nice job on the splash. You guys took care of me." But oddly enough, you know another reason why I hate the Nasty Boys?
Why?
In WCW, they fucking hurt people for real. The job guys.
Mm-hmm.
You know who those job guys were? My friends.
They would suplex.
You know the belly to back suplex that looks like an atomic drop, but you fall backwards.
Mm-hmm.
They would do that to guys, and their knees would hit themselves in the face, knock them out cold. And they would do it on purpose, and they would punch. You know who else did shit like that? Brian Pillman. He would slap. Remember when he slapped the guys in the ears?
Mm-hmm.
He blew their eardrums out. There was so many guys left wrestling because that dude slapped them, and their eardrum blew out, and they lost hearing in their ear. Not all the hearing, but there was bleeding. Oh, he knocked the shit out of them. And that's the thing. Guys like that were never job guys, so they don't respect the guys who are. That's a lack of gratitude. And I love Brian Pillman. I don't like the Nasty Boys.
But you know karma. Scott Hall and Kevin Nash got revenge on the Nasty Boys. Yes.
That's karma for sure. Because go back and watch them on WCW, then watch them in WWF. WWF, they take care of you. WCW, no one policed it. So if they were just killing guys, they'd kill guys, and that was that. The only two guys I know for sure who used to kill guys, but they didn't kill them like that. Like, that's reckless. That's where you hurt somebody and end their career. The APA used to beat the fuck out of guys, but just stiff, not trying to kill you. You got clothesline? You got clothesline. Ron Simmons gave you the fucking spine buster or the power slam? You lost air in your lungs, right?
Mm-hmm.
But it looked good. It looked good. And they did it to everybody. They didn't just do it to the job guys. They did it to everybody. Vader did it to everybody. And then guys did it back. If you didn't, Shawn Michaels. That's a classic one. Vader's kicking his ass. Bulldog in WCW. Vader's kicking his ass. Bulldog slammed him and jumped on his rib cage and said, Leon, ease up. And from all accounts, Vader was a gem of a human being, like a sensitive guy, not an asshole.
Very fragile.
Tell him, hey man, you're fucking killing me out there. Oh, I didn't know. I think at one time they said Sting, Cactus Jack, and Ron Simmons were the only three guys who would work with Flair or work with Vader because of how stiff he was. And then Flair did it. But stuff like that. But we're digressing. Yeah. None of those guys had anything to do with PWF.
No, but again, we just wanted to give a little bit of what we saw here. Into the backstage politics or backstage, you know, teachings of a wrestler, you know, trying to take care of each other. Let's close this out, TW, because we talked so long. You love this, the spot. I mean, Steve Keirn is having a war with the Southern Force for the PWF Tag Team Champions. That's not the issue because I don't know who his tag team partner is. Is it Scott Hall? Or is it Dick Slater? Because at the end of the show, Dick Slater was with Steve Keirn, and you just wanted to talk about Dick Slater, and you just wanted to talk. So let's close this out with Dick Slater.
He's someone that can't talk, like historically. He's a guy from UWF. He's a guy from NWA. He's a guy from World Class, from Global. That guy, WWF, that guy's been everywhere. And, you know, you had Terry Funk, you had Dory Funk, and then you had Jimmy Jack Funk, which was Sandy Barr's son. Why the fuck did they ever not make Dick Slater a funk? Tell me he doesn't sound exactly like Terry Funk, like his voice.
I mean, everything but he always
everything he says.
But he wore the Confederate stuff. I mean, we knew what he was. He was so identifiable with that. He's Dirty Dick. Again?
Can't hear you. Say something now. I see you now. You're moving.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now. So go back to Dick Slater.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I wonder why he was never a Funk. Like, he sounds like Terry Funk.
But he's so identifiable with the Confederacy stuff. He's a dirty Dick Slater with the Confederate stuff. That's what I was trying to say.
You're saying it's too late. Like, he's too big. I meant someone had to see that before he became either in popular and whatever. Mm-hmm. Wasn't he with, he was with Bunkhouse Bunk, wasn't he?
Yeah, Bunkhouse Buck, yes. But he was still dirty Dick Slater. Dirty Dick Slater no matter what.
He's underrated. He's just what Travis would call a good hand, Dick Slater.
Mm-hmm. No, I
can see him going in Hall of Fame. He probably never will, but I can see it.
He probably is in the Pro Wrestling Hall of Fame, the Bill After Hall of Fame, if I'm not mistaken.
Right, yeah.
So,
he deserves it. Dick Slater's a good dude.
But you wanted to talk about the promo. I mean, you was like, he was crazy here. I mean, Dick Slater.
Here's what he said in this promo. In a nutshell, you can just imagine how shitty the rest of it is. He fucks up and says, "Big Steel Man, you might beat me on that night," after saying how he was going to beat his ass, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then he goes, "But you might not beat me. But when it's all said and done, I might be cutting my forehead. I might." And then you can just see he's like, "Where the fuck am I going?" Like, once he realized he messed up and said, "You might beat me that night," it was over. And then he just started saying anything. And then they go over to Steve Keirn, who puts over Florida again, and then tells everybody, like, you can tell he's booking it, Steve Keirn, because everything he's saying is like, all the talent needs to know we're in Florida, we're for Florida, I'm from Florida, Dick Slater's from Florida, we're all Florida. Florida's where it's at. Well, so much for your global when you're fucking putting Florida over. And then Dick Slater goes, "Come here, Gordon," and starts talking again and says, "You know, I'm upset, so I'm saying crazy things, and, you know, there's a lot of things got me upset these days," and then he starts going downhill again from there. I just thought, good Lord. Like, why Vince has scripts.
Of course, and the funny thing about Steve Keirn, he goes from a fabulous one to Gator Keirn, and then he's Skinner.
Worst mullet ever.
Yeah, that's a bad mullet. And with that being said, Reflectionites, we close on the PWF and TW. I mean, we're not grading this episode because it's not fair to give it a grade. But to me, this is a gem. I'm not giving it an A because it's a great episode. It's a gem to find things like this. Your last parting words about this.
I would like to find more.
Okay.
Yeah, me too. I would like to find more of it. Like, you know, one thing that I always think that I want to do, but I, you know, Travis used to be pretty good at telling me when they added content or I'd get emails. I would like to go back, and I got friends that, like, make comments on my action figure posts and stuff about watching wrestling with their kids. Like, I would like Vince to buy this stuff, brush it up, clean it up. I'm sure they're going to change all the music. But I would like to go back and figure out a way. Kind of, this is like the MCU, right? Where what order do you watch all these movies to make it even better? Because some are origin stories, and others are just, you know, what tic tacs to the other one to make the toe. I would like to go back to 1985 and watch Saturday Night up to Starcade or build up to Great American Bash, and then watch that and go back like I'm seeing it for the first time. Because for you and me, I would be. I didn't watch it in 85. Mm-hmm. So obviously, a lot of the outcomes, but not the undercards, not the Saturday night shows, you know. So it would actually, I think if something like this was there, especially if PWF was only around for 6 months, you know, because, like, I'm still waiting on UWF. They got Mid-South, but it ends when it becomes UWF because some assholes out there holding out on selling it to them. I would love to be able to go back and recreate it. And the cool thing is I wouldn't have to wait a week. I could watch 4 weeks worth of Saturday nights and then watch the Clash of Champions that it was setting up in a weekend, you know? And so if the PWF was on there, or the UWF, or like, I tried doing that with Mid-South, but it's just too, they didn't build to anything. It was just week to week to week, so you get burned out. But but they're building towards Homecoming too. So if we could go back and build the Homecoming 1 and, you know, stuff like that, and like NXT, I would like to go back. It's like 4 years worth of NXT on there, and it's only been NXT for however long. But
there's NXT Talent Search, right? No, I understand, but there's NXT Talent Search on Sci-Fi, and then the NXT on the network. So there's there's two different NXTs. I get what you're saying. So with that being said,
I want to go back and watch the FCW stuff with Ricky Steamboat's son and Seth Rollins when he was Tyler Black, or I think he was Seth right away, but right when he got there and all that. I like finding stuff like this. You just know that I hate watching the shit on YouTube. It just looks terrible. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they would clean it up if they put it on the network, at least try to.
Yeah, we'll see. I mean, again, copyrights, you know, somebody holding the tapes, they want to get paid a lot from Vince McMahon. So with that being said, Reflectionites, we close on this episode 128 of the PWR podcast at PWHustle Networks at Podbean.com. So TW, you got to go and eat the gummy bear of death. So give out the social media stuff so we can go home.
All right. These are all Twitters. The show is at PW Reflection. Then you got me at Tommy Wonder 19 is my politics one, at the Tommy Wonder is my wrestling one. Our good man can't do this show without him. Big Ray is at Big Ray's Ministry. Our guy still recovering from that damn pounce he got from Keith Lee. At P1JB is JB's Twitter handle. Then my Facebook is / Tommy Wonder. I do have another one that just says Tommy Wonder. So if you see it, I'm trying to only add people that I physically know. Not physically, but no. Like, I know you, so you're on there. People that I actually know. So that's only there for when inevitably I get banned on the other Facebook again so that I can still continue to talk. Because the next one's going to be a week. So I just, you know, I needed it to be able to keep in touch with people. I'm sure it's got 100 friends on it. I'm sure it's going to steamroll into me. I got a couple on there I don't know because right away I added everybody. But anyway, that's that. And then I don't know what my snap. And then if you want to watch the Gummy Bear Challenge, go to YouTube and search for Dum Dum Duo. There's only two videos so far. By the time this airs, it'll be three, maybe four if they add my one chip challenge and I bitch about mine not being on there. And you can laugh at us and put a picture of the face to the voice. And you can see what a smaller Santa Claus looks like.
Okay. And me at my Twitter, PROFPWHustle. I don't get banned. I know what to say. I know how to play the game when it comes to Twitter. Twitter doesn't ban the professor because he just knows how to toe that line.
YouTube's doing it.
Yeah. So, and of course, follow us on the PWHustle Networks on YouTube. Follow my guys, you know, Billy Ray Valentine, Mr. Infinite Fringe himself at Obi-Wan, you know me. And of course, the man, you know, shout outs to this man who actually put some videos to this PWR Reflection podcast here. So shout outs to A-Track Brown, the dirtiest of the city at A-Track Dastly. I don't know what we're going to do. I'm going to try to find another gym out there on YouTube. So, you know, it could be FCW, could be AWA, could be GLOW. Who knows? So stay tuned, Reflectionites. Hey. Stay tuned. And what?
What if you found Homecoming 2?
I'll see if I can try to find... I can find Homecoming 1. That's an easy one. But let's see if I can find Homecoming 2. So, with that being said, I'm the Professor. That's Mr. Wonderful, TW, a.k.a. Tommy Strong, a.k.a. Tommy Wonder, saying goodnight and see ya next time here on the PWR Podcast at Podbean.com. Peace!
Brother.